So if you think about when you're walking down the street, all of the things that you are experiencing, and the things you have to do, just do that one simple motion. You're walking down the sidewalk. And what you need is this feedback from your joints and your body so that you can walk, from your skin to tell you if there's a breeze coming by, is that breeze warm or cool? All of that information is coming through your skin and your muscles to your brain, and you have receptors that are sort of detecting all this stuff. And what I think is so fascinating about these particular patients is that they have a mutation, a genetic mutation, that silences some of that information coming into their brain. And the things that are silenced have not been seen before in people.
So I'm a pediatric neurologist and a geneticist by training, and one of the missions we have here at the NIH is to go and find the genetic cause of unexplained neurological disorders in children. What was very striking to me when I first saw these patients was this combination of scoliosis, curvature of the spine that was there from birth, and then an apparent lack of a perception of joint position that was quite complete to a degree that I had never seen before. And yet the strength was preserved, intelligence was preserved. It was just a selective loss of the sense of joint position, which is proprioception, that really caught my attention.
One of the senses they're missing is the so-called sixth sense of proprioception, which is knowing where your limbs are relative to each other in space. And in the absence of that information, you don't know where your hand is relative to your body, and you can imagine how that might affect your movement.
Probably the most beautiful example of proprioception in action is Simone Biles at the Olympics. Because she, at every nanosecond of what she does, she has an acute sense of where every part of her body is in space.
Each patient has a mutation in the same gene, and the gene is called piezo-2. And what this gene was proposed to do is to sit inside of a cell or a neuron or your body, and whenever some pressure or force happens, this gene gets sort of, you can imagine being sort of opened up, and that opening allows the cell to know that something's happened by allowing ions to flow into it. So for instance, if someone presses on your hand, and your skin starts to deform, all of that skin is stretching around that thing that's deforming your hand. And what this molecule is doing is it's sitting in the neurons in your hand, and as those forces start stretching your skin apart, this molecule also gets stretched apart. You can imagine if somebody came in with a scissor and just cut the molecule in half. That's pretty much what these mutations have done. They've just completely chopped the molecule in half and destroyed its ability to function.
What is remarkable, these patients have not lost piezo-2, they've never had it. So there's not a developed sense of proprioception, because this being a genetic mutation, there was never ever a functional piezo-2 in any cells of these patients. So they were born and developed without piezo-2 as a mechanotransductor. And so this was a unique opportunity for us to learn what happens to a human being, what happens to a nervous system, how you function, what's your daily life like if you don't have that sense.
Yeah, walking into the room for the first time, it was a pretty overwhelming experience. I was very humbled to be in the presence of a patient.
We can't really know how they cope and what they experience, because they've never known anything else. And so what they've developed is lots of little strategies that they are not really aware of, even how to cope with these deficits. Well, one example is writing or to draw something. So you can imagine if you don't have sensory feedback from your fingers, if you don't know where your fingers are in space, writing gets extremely difficult. And so both of these patients have developed a very effective way of visually controlling every single movement of the pen. So constantly looking at it, controlling it, and that's a natural way of writing. If you ask them to write or draw with the eyes closed, then it gets very, very difficult. You and I would be able to write a letter, a word, a little figure with your eyes closed quite naturally, and this is completely impossible for these patients. And yet, successful in school, in university, with their mechanisms of compensation.
Clearly, this is a study that I would have never been even part of if it wasn't for the fact that I was here at the NIH and we had this really incredible clinical research program happening. So Carsten contacted me as a basic scientist I was able to interact with the clinical center and sort of bring my knowledge of the basic science to aid in this study. But then also, while working with Carsten, learned so much more about this gene and its role in humans that I can now bring that experience back into my lab.
These patients are already teaching us what to do by showing us that sensory and compensatory inputs from vision and other, perhaps for not yet clear to us, channels allow them to function as well as they do. And I think that gives us channels to tap into, to use in treatments, to teach the nervous system to work around deficits that are there, such as loss of proprioception.